where she gathered all her artistic tools to better her craft to be the best painter that you can meet today. When you and your husband moved to Asia, particularly in Singapore, you lived, I don't know why I'm saying this to you, like you don't know my story, but yes, you lived in a big tower apartment block, and as many do out there, because it's a very large city, this made her look up at the tall buildings more most while she was there and take note of the sky and light out there. It's very, Singapore is very famous for its ever-changing weather and clear skies, so you took great inspiration from this. So Charlotte, you are travelling next month to September for your Singapore solo show at your gallery out there. And you have many galleries that you're a part of, including us in the UK, France, Australia and Singapore. Mm-hmm. So I think it's fair to say that perhaps travelling helps you keep being inspired with new creations and create different series to work on.
Yeah, definitely. I think this is almost what we were just talking about, in that you stop seeing things after a while. New horizons are really refreshing.
Yes.
So travelling is the ultimate of that. You go somewhere new vistas, new skylines, new skies. It refreshes, and then you come back and you think, you know, I lived overseas for 4 years, and when I went back to the UK, I realised how much I missed of the weather, the climate, the views. I grew up in Dartmoor in Devon, which is a very particular landscape, which I was desperate to leave at 18. Thing in the world, and then returning to it at 35, I realised how fantastic it was as an inspiration as an artist. And it's to see something with fresh eyes when you left and come back.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so was pandemic quite challenging for you then?
I suppose so, but in some ways it was almost to have this imposed, there's no FOMO, there's no, you need to go somewhere and do something, like you can't go anywhere and do anything. So just buckle down and enjoy what you've got. Yeah. And we'd just come back to the UK at that point, and I'd moved to Yorkshire then, so I was living in a new part of the UK, a landscape I didn't know. And it was actually a really delightful time, which is not a nice thing to say about pandemic. But the first lockdown, we were living in a very rural place. When we lived overseas in Singapore, you don't have seasons. It's always hot, there's no autumn, the leaves don't change, the skies don't change. And I came back to the UK and we had this enforced lockdown. I couldn't go anywhere. I could only appreciate what was around me in this very small way. And I really appreciated the very simple things of watching the landscape around me change, the colours, the skies, the wildlife. So the pandemic wasn't difficult. It was refreshing in some ways.
That's fantastic.
A different experience for me as a painter, and I drew different things from it.
Yeah.
And I found it very powerful. And I did a period of time where I tried to make very positive, uplifting works deliberately because we were in a pandemic. And it was very gratifying to find that there were a lot of people suddenly who may not have purchased art before, and they were stuck at home looking at their walls, suddenly felt they wanted to buy art, and they wanted to buy art that didn't challenge or wasn't complicated or political. They wanted to buy art that made them feel comforting and reassured, sure, and I feel like that's what I wanted to make.
We definitely found that as a gallery, so it was great to hear that you...
Yeah, it was okay.
Yeah, it was alright. We pulled through.
Now we're going back to the negatives.
Now we're doing really negative paintings from now. I don't think I've ever done visual paintings, actually. I think I've got it in.
So a little bit said in your introduction, but you trained originally to be a painter in the theatre,
yeah.
And you did that for 15 years, which went very well, and you were very successful. What kind of brought you into that world, which then has led you on to be a solo artist today?
So I worked in the theatre, I painted backcloths for West End shows and the Opera House and all around in London and all over the world. I went into that because I believed in the power, and I still do, the power of theatre in terms of storytelling, in terms of what it does and what it gives to us as a society. But I'm a backstage person. I don't want to be on a stage, I want to paint things. But I believe in the collective power of performance and storytelling in theatre. So for me it was a wonderful time, because as a scenic artist, my job was to create someone else's vision. So you put your ego at the door, nobody cares what you think, what you want to express personally. You need to learn how to use these tools, these paints, these materials to fulfill a brief. You do that for enough years, you really understand the tools and the mediums. And so when the time came when I felt powerful enough to create work of my own and express something I wanted to say, I felt like I've got a whole toolbox of stuff that I've learned because I learned to do it without that ego at the beginning.
Yeah.
So it's really important to me, and I can't really explain what it's like to be part of working. We did the set for the 2012 Olympics, you know, the Danny Boyle thing, and to be part of that team, you know, we worked on that for a year, and to be part of something so collectively important and uplifting, it was a really moving experience.
That's and a really powerful time.
It was so great. And so I learned all these skills, and I never really felt confident to show. I always painted my own paintings, and I never showed them to anybody. And I worked as a painter for 15 years, and then it wasn't until I got older and became a mother, and I changed as a person, that I thought, I'm now raising another generation, and I'm telling her, be brave, be bold, do the thing you want to do, believe in yourself, and I'm not doing that, so it's time to actually believe in who I am and what I do, and to paint paintings that are from a place that is personal and private and important, and to have the faith that they will make their way in the world, and people will understand them.
People were very glad you made that leap.
No, amazing, thank you.
So I think it's fair to say nature is very much what inspires you for your work. You've done several series over time, sign series, wild oceans, for me, it's here, which are beautiful. What art do you most identify with and find important to you, and what do you find integral as an artist?
What in terms of the work I make? I like the idea of there being no sense of scale. I don't ever put anything man-made into my pieces, so I do sort of wide landscapes, wild oceans, skyscapes and things, and I never add an element that can tie them down to a particular place or a particular scale. I like the idea as the viewer, you see what you want to see, you feel what you want to feel, it takes you back to a memory of a bit of childhood. It's timeless, it's placeless, it's without class, it's without gender, it's an emotional response to the world that we're all existing in, and hopefully they just make you feel a bit warm inside, really. And that's really all
I can do. Yeah, do that very well. That's beautiful. You've done so many projects already, but is there sort of a dream project?
I love working on a really big scale,
okay.
So I can see these small pictures.
Yes.
And the bigger the better, because sorry, I'm going to say this again, I'm searching once already. Like a big painting for me is a transfer of energy. And all of these pieces are my heart and my soul and my physical being, but a big painting that you can't, that's outside of your realm of reach, that you have to stand on a chair to get to the top corner. They have to, when I lie things on the ground, I've got to run around it because bits of it's drying before I want it to. It takes a different level of my being. And I really love that. I love painting and feeling tired at the end of the day. Like I've given it not just my emotion, but all of me. And so dream jobs for me are always when people say, what a massive painting.
Okay, so what is a commission then?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't like doing commissions. I do take commissions, but only for people who are open to the fact that I paint what I paint.
Of course,
within
yeah.
a certain boundary. But I can't, you know, if you show me a photo and ask for it, I can do it, but I'm not going to.
Yeah, and, it's got to be in your internal style.
If someone says, massive, you've got a huge gallery, you want 4 meter paintings, I'd be delighted. I'd like to do a whole wall of these, for instance.
We will try and make that happen. That's what I'd like to do. I mean, you're so successful in your own right, but has anyone given you any advice along the way in your journey?
Loads of advice. I think the most powerful thing was when I lived in Singapore, and I was quite early days showing work, and I still get very nervous, but I used to get incredibly nervous showing people things. It makes you feel very vulnerable, something that you've done. It's such an isolating, you're in your studio, just you doing your thing, and then suddenly you're putting a painting in front of a whole bunch of you guys, and you're all looking at it and thinking things, and it's absolutely terrifying to throw up before events. And I was working on an art fair in Singapore several years ago with an older artist. He was an Iranian artist, and he was probably in his 60s. very kind about my work, but the most powerful thing he said to me was, there's a lid for every pot. There is someone out there for every painting that is made. Don't change who you are because of what people are telling you or what you're hearing or what people are buying. Don't think, oh, these pink ones are successful, paint a lot of pink ones. Don't think, you know, social media gives you this constant barrage. I can spend all of my coffee breaks in my studio looking at other people's paintings.
Analytics, yeah.
Actually really quite distracting because suddenly you say, oh God, they look great and they're clearly selling. And it's so easy to find your own style being slightly eroded by everything around you. And the way I paint comes from a really real place. It comes from years of learning to paint as a scenic artist. And you know, I'm proud of the way I paint. And initially, when I first started showing my own work, it was really hard not to see other people and feel like, I'm going to do a little bit like hers because hers are nicer than mine. And actually, no, that is not the way. Like, if you can stay true to the stuff that you do and know that fashions will change for art, but if you're painting something that has a real integrity, real heart, you know, it'll come in and out of fashion, but it will stay because it's real. And so I always think that whenever I'm working on anything, I think of my friend Ali, who's opposite me, because he's absolutely right. Anyone who's bought my work and contacted me afterwards, they believe it. And that's because it's from a place that I care about.
And what a bit of you, really, but of your soul that you put in there, and so to change that is being fake and semantic to yourself.
It is, but it's really hard to keep a Instagram is the worst. It gets in and it's insidious, and you find yourself distracted by all of the or watching hours of Johnny Depp trying to convince you should be
paying. Yeah, I mean, you'll tell it too.
That's terrible. I think it probably is that because I'm trying to
very touchy what you have said about that advice that your teacher told you. I like it very much.
Good, yeah, thank you. I still think of it all the time.
Yes, nice.
So all of the art that you did before you became an artist, what happened to it?
It's all over the place.
Where did you send it?
Well, I used to give stuff away and all kinds of things. It's all over the place.
So there's no secret skip
somewhere. A bunker somewhere. It's a bunker that I'll release. Well, maybe. There's bits and bobs all over the place, but mostly I'm working to my own. So I never believed in it. I didn't believe I was doing anything of value until I decided to choose to do something of value, you know?
So I have a tiny question.
I know every artist has their roots. How did you get from being a set painter to exhibiting in galleries? What was the process or what was the road?
So in some ways, because we moved overseas, and when I was a scenic artist, my work was very much based in London. So I knew I needed to make a change, and it gave me the impetus to do that. In some ways, I think I was probably lucky in that I started creating works. I felt really nervous about them. I showed them to a friend of a friend when I was living in Asia. I'd never really shown anyone that wasn't like my mother.
Yeah.
And this friend, she's a New Zealander, she's very honest. And I said, I want to show you my paintings, what do you think? And then she came in and she went, oh, thank God, I like them. Okay. Oh, no, I thought I was going to really hate them and I was going to really upset you. Great. No, I like them. These are good. And I thought, okay, so if I've won her over, this is a really good start because she's tough. So it sort of grew gradually from there. Instagram was a very strong tool in that as soon as a bit of traction happened, galleries approached me. There was a very strong gallery in Singapore where we were living that approached me straight away, had a real success with my work. And so it's sort of little building blocks. You know, you have one gallery that works and believes in you, and they can show other galleries that you make work that people believe in and want to buy. Then it sort of slowly grows from there. You know, you just need one person to believe in you to start with, really. And in some ways it was easier doing that, not in London, because here I'd been Charlotte the scenic artist for 15 years, not Charlotte the fine artist, and it was a transition that was easier to do, not under that gaze, you know, reinvention.
Do all the events inspire you to paint? And like, you mentioned the Olympics, for example.
Yeah.
Do you focus on a particular world event or a personal event? Or
I do. I mean, things like the pandemic's hard to ignore, so that definitely crept in. But I'm one of those really awful people that tries not to watch much of the news because I find it too upsetting. So, no, I wouldn't say they do, not in that way, but I don't think my responses are that literal, I guess. I pick things that I enjoy to work on, so a lot of the pieces, I'm going to paint a skyscape and I'm going to base it on a sky that maybe was a photograph that was taken somewhere. I might look at some of the local folklore or music or poetry of that area. I've done a whole series of work that was based when we went to Scotland and I read a whole bunch of poetry, listened to this amazing folk music and things. So I try and layer the work with other cultural experiences. But anything sad, I don't want to think about, which is really poor. But there's a lot of people out there making work about sad things, and I'm the other guy. My brother is a musician. I have a younger brother who's 10 years younger. He's very close to me, but he's a complicated soul. He's had some difficult times and some depression in his life. And he writes beautiful music, and he wrote this song called The Sailor's Escape. And I painted a painting named for the song and based on his song years ago, which was put into an exhibition. And then it didn't sell. And it was supposed to go to another exhibition. And I couldn't do it because it was his painting, and so that's one of the only pieces, because I don't tend to keep my own work around because I don't like to see it. I like it to continue its journey on with someone else. But that one, because it was so personal to Ed and the words he'd written in his music, he has that one. I gave it to him and it hangs in his house.
and every time I go around, I forget. I go, oh no, look, there it is. And it makes me feel a bit weird, but also I know that it meant something to him to keep it. So yeah, just that one really. I feel like my paintings can finish their journey when someone else takes them. You know, they have a home to go to that's not with me.
Do you have an artist that you stalk?
Sorry?
Do you have an artist that you stalk?
That I stalk? I have loads of artists out on Instagram.
Like as in to own or...
Oh, as in to own or...
Oh,
it's tricky that. I mean, there's lots. There's so many. I don't know. That's tricky. I feel like it would be unfair on all the ones I can't remember.
Yours in any way, or is it totally
different? It's very different as a rule. I don't hang any of my work at home because I can't switch off. If I see it in my house, I'm thinking, well, that might be nice with another little thing like that, so I can't. I share my studio with a fellow artist. My home is full of her art. If she's always doing stuff, going, no, that's no good, and throwing it away. I'm going, this is not going to take it home. So my house is full of Millie's work, which I love. And just different things. We collect things, we have moved. Things that aren't necessarily an investment, but they're something that speaks of a place and a memory, and so that's what I have around me. Really.
Have you framed any of your children's work? Will they become great artists?
Loads of it. I have a huge piece. I have a piece that's about 1.70 meters that my daughter did when she was 2, and I've got a video of her completely naked in Singapore with a roller in one hand and a brush in the other, like completely going for it on this huge canvas that was taller than she was, and I have that painting in my house. And people come in who don't know my work, they know I'm an artist, and they go, oh, is that your work? That happens to me all the time. And I have to say, oh, no, I actually cursed in that, which was too so, yes, that's actually my prize for that.
Did your style change when you moved from Singapore to back to UK? Because you said there's more drama and story.
Definitely. And when sometimes I paint pieces that I know I'm sending to Singapore, and I always switch back to the style that I used when I lived over there. There's the climate, the skies, the atmosphere here is so different to a climate like Singapore, to the tropics, that like my colour palette really shifted, like almost immediately, and I have to change my mindset back to tropic climate colour palette.
So is there a geography? A global geography that you want to go to paint in your life? Is there a destination?
We're always planning to move to New Zealand to be a month because I think that would suit both of us and that would suit me a lot. But I mean, everywhere I go, I find something. And I love being by the sea, I love painting oceans as well. There's something about that huge energy that is really hard to capture. You know, the day you paint an ocean and you're pleased with it, it's then you're tired. So, okay. Yeah, one of those things.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Can we have a round of applause? Yeah, well, please continue having some drinks. Looking at the shrimp.